a Divine Mercy Parish video presentation.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
My dear brothers and sisters, on this most sacred night, in which our Lord Jesus Christ passed from death to life, the Church calls upon her sons and daughters scattered throughout the world to come together to watch and pray. If we keep the memorial of the Lord's Paschal solemnity this way, listening to his word and celebrating his mysteries, that we shall have the sure hope of sharing his triumph over death and living with him in God. Let us pray. O God, who through your Son bestowed upon the faithful the fire of your glory, sanctify this new fire, we pray, and grant that by these paschal celebrations we may be so inflamed with heavenly desires that with mind made pure, we may obtain the festivals of unending pleasure through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Christ, yesterday and today, the Alpha and Omega, all time belongs to him, and all the ages, to him be glory and power through every age, forever and ever. By his holy and glorious wounds, may Christ the Lord grant us and protect us. Amen. May the light of Christ, rising in glory, dispel the darkness of our hearts and minds.
Thank you.
My dear brothers and sisters, now that we have become our solemn vigil, let us listen with quiet hearts to the word of God. Let us meditate on how God in times past saved his people, and in these the last days has sent us his Son as our Redeemer. Let us pray that our God may complete this pastoral work of salvation by the fullness of redemption.
creeping things, and wild animals of every kind. And so it happened. God made all kinds of wild animals, all kinds of cattle, and all kinds of creeping things on the earth. God saw how good it was. And God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and the cattle, and over all wild animals, and all the creatures that crawl on the ground." God created man in his image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, saying, "Be firm and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and all the living things that move on the earth." God also said, "See, I give you every seed-bearing plant all over the earth, and every tree that has seed-bearing fruit on it, to be your food. And to all the animals of the land, all the birds of the air, and all the living creatures that crawl on the ground, I give all the green plants for food." And so it happened. God looked at everything he had made, and he found it very good. Evening came, and morning followed, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and all their array were completed. Since on the seventh day, God was finished with the work he had done. He rested on the seventh day from all the work he had undertaken. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. Thank you. Lord, said to Moses, why are you crying out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward. And you, lift up your staff, and with hand outstretched over the sea, split the sea in two, that the Israelites may pass through it on dry land. But I will make the Egyptians so obstinate that they will go in after them. Then I will receive glory through Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and his charioteers. The Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I receive glory through Pharaoh and his chariots and charioteers. The angel of God, who had been leading Israel's camp, now moved and went around behind them. The column of cloud also, leaving the front, took up its place behind them, so that it came between the camp of the Egyptians and that of Israel. But the cloud now became dark, and thus the night passed, without the rival camps coming any closer together all night long. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord swept the sea with a strong east wind throughout the night, and so it turned into dry land. When the water was less divided, the Israelites marched into the midst of the sea on dry land, with the water like a wall to their right and to their left. The Egyptians followed in pursuit. All Pharaoh's horses and chariots and charioteers went after them, right into the midst of the sea. In the night watch, just before dawn, the Lord cast through the column of fiery cloud upon the Egyptians' force a glance that threw it into a panic. And he so clogged their chariot wheels that they could hardly drive. With that, the Egyptians sounded the retreat before Israel, because the Lord was fighting for them against the Egyptians. Then the Lord told Moses, stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may flow back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and their charioteers. So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea flowed back to its normal depth. The Egyptians were fleeing head on toward the sea when the Lord hurled them into its midst as the water flowed back. It covered the chariots and the charioteers of Pharaoh's whole army, which had followed the Israelites into the sea. Not a single one of them escaped. But the Israelites had marched on dry land to the midst of the sea, with the water like a wall to their right and to their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel on that day, power of the Egyptians. When Israel saw the Egyptians lying dead on the seashore, and beheld the great power that the Lord had shown against the Egyptians, they feared the Lord and believed in him and in his servant Moses. Then Moses and the Israelites sang a song to the Lord. I will sing to the Lord, for he is gloriously triumphant. Horse and chariot he has cast
O God, for what ancient wonders we made out of dim and splendor even in our day, for what you once bestowed on a single people, freeing them from Pharaoh's persecution by the power of your right hand, now you bring about as the salvation of the nations through the waters of rebirth. Grant we pray that the whole world may become children of Abraham and inherit the dignity of Israel's birthright through Christ our Lord.
We shall also be united with him in the resurrection. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that in our sinful body we might be done away with, that we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For a dead person has been absolved from sin. If then we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. As to his death, he died to sin once and for all. As to his life, he lives for God. Consequently, you too must think of yourself as being dead to sin and living for God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
He has been raised, he is not here. Behold the place.
The Gospel of the Lord. And my friends, this evening we once again reflect on the greatest act of love that has ever been recorded. For in the early morning hours, the women go to Jesus' tomb to prepare his body for final burial. They go to perform an act of compassion, a traditional act of affection for a close friend. They had followed Jesus. They had listened to his words, and they had put all their hope and trust in him. Therefore, it was fitting that they now accompanied him to the very end. We can only imagine their feelings as they made their way to the tomb. They are in great distress. Jesus has left them. He had died. His life was now over. They were crossed. Their life would now go on as if Jesus never existed. However, something completely new and unexpected happened. They see the stone removed from the entrance of the tomb. They enter, and they do not find the Lord's body. It is an event which leaves them fearful, hesitant, and full of questions. What happened? What's the meaning of all this? Doesn't the same thing, though, also happen to us when something completely new occurs in our everyday life? Newness can often make us fearful, including the newness that comes from God. We are like the disciples of the gospel. Sometimes we would prefer to hold on to what is familiar. Is it not easier then to stand in front of the tomb and reflect on someone who only now lives on as a memory? However, as all of us know, God is full of surprises, and he continues to surprise us as he surprised the disciples on that first Easter Sunday morning. Today, let us be open to the surprises and the newness that God wants to bring into our lives. Are we tired or sad? Do we feel weighed down by life's sins or challenges? Do we think that we are unable to cope? We should never lose heart that God is always present to surprise us. Let us never lose our confidence in God's love. Let us never give up. There is no situation which God cannot change. There is no sin which God cannot forgive. The women who journeyed to the tomb knew something extraordinary had happened. The body of Jesus was gone. And so questions began to arise. Then suddenly, there was an angel in dazzling garments announcing a message that would forever change the course of human history. Do not be amazed. You see Jesus of Nazareth. He is not here. He has been raised. Going to the tomb, a simple act of love, now turned into a life-changing event. The resurrection of Jesus confirmed that the scandal of the cross was not the end of the story. The empty tomb symbolizes a new creation, a creation of new life. The resurrection of Jesus was not a coming back from the dead. It was an event that goes beyond death. What should continue to surprise us is what surprised those who discovered the empty tomb on that first Easter morning. That the impossible had occurred. It happened. New life had been born out of death. The empty tomb then symbolizes a radical new beginning for Jesus and for all humanity. Because death was not the end for Jesus, then death is not the end for us. The resurrection of Jesus is proof that God has conquered death itself. The resurrection is not just an historical event, it is an eternal pledge, a pledge of the future glory that awaits each one of us. Because of the resurrection, no situation in life is hopeless. If God can bring new life from death, then he can also give us hope. Give hope to the sick and the sorrowful, shelter to the homeless and the immigrant, and peace to a troubled world. And so, my friends, on this Easter Sunday, may we continue to be surprised by God's love, so that we can proclaim with joyful hope the message that Christians have proclaimed now for over 2,000 years. Alleluia, alleluia. Christ is risen. Christ has truly risen. My dear brothers and sisters, let us humbly beseech the Lord our God to bless this water he has created, which will be sprinkled upon us as a memorial of our baptism. May he graciously renew us, that we may remain faithful to the Spirit whom we have received. Lord our God, in your mercy, be present to your people who keep vigil on this most sacred night, and for us who recall the wondrous work of our creation and still greater work of our redemption, graciously bless this water, for you have created water to make the fields fruitful and to refresh and cleanse our bodies. You also make water the instrument of your mercy, for through water you free your people from slavery and quench their thirst in the desert. Through water the prophets proclaimed a new covenant you were to enter upon with the human race, and at last of all, through water which Christ made holy in the Jordan, you have renewed our corrupt nature in the back of regeneration. Therefore, may this water be for us a memorial of the baptism we have received, and grant we may share in the gladness of our brothers and sisters who at Easter have received their baptism through Christ our Lord. My dear brothers and sisters, for the Paschal mystery, we have been buried with Christ in baptism so that we may walk with him in newness of life. And so, now that our Lenten observance is concluded, let us renew the promises of holy baptism by which we will renounce Satan and all his works and promise to serve God in his holy Catholic Church. And so I ask you, do you renounce Satan and all his works?
church, reborn in the risen Lord, that we may continually bear witness to the effect of the resurrection on our lives, giving us and the whole world joy, hope, and peace. We pray to the Lord. That the resurrection of our Lord may bring comfort to those who suffer, hope to those who despair, and new life to those who are dying. We pray to the Lord. That the risen Lord may move the hearts of all those who are in conflict with one another, whether in wars between nations or grudges between neighbors, bringing peace and reconciliation among all God's children. We pray to the Lord. For the newest members of the church everywhere, that the good work the Lord has begun in them may continue to bear fruit. We pray to the Lord. For those who have suffered loss and are alone on this Easter Sunday, that they may be comforted by the eternal spiritual bond they have with those they love. We pray to the Lord. For all those who have died, that the promise of the Lord's resurrection may be realized. We pray to the Lord.
Gracious and loving God, through the suffering, death, and resurrection of Christ our Son, you open the gates of paradise to all who believe. We ask you to hear our prayers on this Easter Sunday and grant them always to Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I ask you to use the candles, and our collection is always taken up on Easter and Christmas to support our priests who have served so faithfully the church in the Archdiocese of Boston, and we're all honored to have a senior priest in our parish, Father Peter Casey, who was given so generously to the church for over 56 years. So please, I ask you on his behalf to be generous.
Thank you.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
Pleased, O God, we pray, to bless the knowledge and approve this offering in every respect.
make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to you, O Lord, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took his precious chalice in his holy, venerable hands, and once more, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Yeah.
After Satan's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope, the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of the first time and ever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not at our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Before I close in prayer and blessing, I would like to take this opportunity, first and foremost, to express our thanks to you for your participation this evening and throughout the entire trip. It's a very important celebration. One celebration that takes place over 3 days, and we have participated in that great mystery of Christ's love. The cross is his victory, and tonight we share that true victory, that death is not the end. Death is the doorway that leads us to life eternal. I would like to thank all those who in any way created this beautiful scene in this church and in St. Mary's and St. Anne's. They have done a magnificent job, quite a crew. They're out there, and I have a ton of strong high school college men because I am no longer able to lift things as I should. I turned 60 last year, and don't tell them. But I'm grateful to that. They're a great committee. They're always there for Easter, Christmas, and they do a great job. I want to thank, as always, our music director, Lois, and our choir who provided beautiful music as we celebrate this great feast day of the Lord's resurrection. And thank all our servers and all, anyway, participated as we come together as a people of faith to celebrate the feast of our redemption. I think that's it.
May Almighty